regrette rien, ni le bien qu'on m'a fait, ni le mal, tout ça m'est bien égal. Non, rien de rien, non, je ne regrette rien, c'est payé.
Hi, welcome to this week's very special episode. We're concentrating on the life and times of Mirka Mora, whose exhibition has just opened this week at the Jewish Museum of Australia. And you just saw a little clip there with some Edith Piaf music, which we all love. And Mirka was a great fan of anything French, as I am. I'm a Francophile. And one of the things that I really admire about Mirka's work was her incredible diversity and her absolute devotion to just churning this stuff out. She had a shtick. And to make this show even more interesting, we're going to LA right now on Zoom to meet her oldest son, Philippe, who now lives in LA. And I'd like to welcome Philippe to the shtick.
Thank you. Look, unlike my mother, I'm sure you're going to be relieved to know that I'm not going to show my bum, okay? I'm happy to talk to you, but no bum.
Well, she was a cultural figure in more ways than one, and she would always love to show her figure and had a very bohemian attitude towards life, which I think was part of her freedom. She was very free.
Well, that's an interesting way of putting it. And yes, she was very free, but I think you've got to put in the context that Mirka and George, my dad, they had just arrived from and survived the Holocaust. So coming to Melbourne in 1951, or whatever it was, maybe it was 50, but Melbourne was, let's say, much quieter than Berlin, 45. And that's so Melbourne was a fantastic relief for them. It was the first time they'd ever relaxed in their life, I think. So they were, yes, free, but I think there was a huge load off their mind. I never understood any of this at the time, by the way. I didn't know why, as a kid, my parents had funny accents. I didn't know why we were in Melbourne. I kept asking questions, which was irritated everyone. And so in many ways, it's a typical immigrant family story of survival.
Well, Charles Blackman did that famous picture of Collins Street where you lived with your family at number 9.
That painting, Melbourne 5 p.m. or whatever it was, that was by John Brack. John Brack.
It was John Brack.
And it's a masterpiece. And I'll tell you why it's a masterpiece, because I lived there. And I went and outside my front door at the top of Collins Street at 5 p.m. every day. I saw that because I was coming home from school. That painting is incredible. That's exactly what it was like. The faces of conservatism, the Australian version. It was incredibly boring if you were an interesting person. So all the interesting people, for some reason, congregated around Mirka and George at the top of Collins Street. They had so many parties there that my dad finally said, you know, we should start a restaurant because I'm going broke. And so they started a restaurant. At least there was some money coming in for the parties. That was the birth of the Mirka Cafe just down the street on Exhibition Street.
And you also fed a lot of artists. All the glorious names of Australian art now were just struggling young artists at that time.
They were totally struggling and hungry. And it's hard to believe, really, considering now that, you know, a Charles Blackman paint, the prices on these works were millions of dollars. But none of them had any money, and my parents didn't have much money. And one of Mirka's great inventions was parsley soup. And so we'd go to the country. I remember Neil Douglas was a character there. He was the gardener, basically, for the Reeds. We'd go out there with the Percivals and our other friends. And there's home movies on all of this stuff, by the way. But Mirka's great invention was parsley soup, which pleased everyone because it didn't cost a penny.
Cost nothing. And you had people like David Boyd and, as we mentioned, Charles Blackman, who all were part of your family when you went out to Heidi. And you said you saw your first television. I remember the first time I saw television. I got so excited.
Was it mind-blowing? But also the Percivals, John Percival and David Boyd, and all these artists would just about every weekend we were at one of these places. And the artists, a big memory for me is they would put each other on trial on their art. They'd take a painting by Charles Blackman, for example, and David Boyd would be the prosecutor and say, this is just shit. And then Arthur Boyd would be the defense and say, no, this is a great painting. You don't understand the history of art. And John Percival would, so they'd all get it. They had trial. They'd put each other on trial.
Yeah.
I don't know how old I was. Not that old. But they were all great actors. And Barry Humphries was there. Mm-hmm. And just an interesting footnote to that, Barry Humphries got a lot of his shtick from Charles Blackman. Charles Blackman was a great actor and he'd do all this stuff. And years later, I saw Barry on stage. I thought, that's what Charles was doing in
the Dame Edna.
Yeah, blah, blah, blah. But they did quite dangerous stuff. David Boyd's big thing was, John Percival's big thing was blowing turpentine on a match. So he was flame eating, or I don't know what you call it. But as kids, of course, we loved it. You know, all the outrageous stuff, we thought it was tremendous. And this is, forgive this a bit, it's a bit crude, but David Boyd's big trick was lighting his farts.
Yes, I know. And, I've heard about that.
And as a kid, can you imagine as a kid seeing an adult do that? We thought that was the coolest thing. Oh, look at that. You know, fortunately, we didn't try it ourselves.
Yeah, we didn't mention that your parents were both Holocaust survivors. Your father was originally from Germany and he went to France and got involved in the underground with your godfather, the very famous and late Marcel Marceau. And your mother also has an interesting Holocaust story where her father was so fortunate and she was the luckiest person on earth to be somehow freed by her father.
Well, look, it's a big story. This is the short version, okay? So all Jews were in Paris were rounded up. I've forgotten the date. It was 42, I think. 42. All the Jews were rounded up. And as I say, this is the brief version. I'll try and make it snappy. But my mother and my two aunts and my grandmother were arrested because my grandfather had gone to buy a newspaper. Luckily, when he came back, they were gone. The neighbors said it was the police had taken them, arrested them. Anyway, in a train, my grandmother looked out at the where they were going, and she told Mirka to write down the names of the stations. So she wrote down like seven or eight stations. This is incredible, really, and. After that, she wrote on the piece of paper to her husband, we're going in this direction. Here are the train stations we're going in. We don't know where we're going. Here are the stations. And she said, if anyone finds this piece of paper, please send it to Leon Zalik at the address in Paris. And she threw it out of the train. Well, someone picked that up. And if someone hadn't picked it up and put a stamp on it and sent it to my grandfather, I wouldn't be sitting here talking to you. So we don't know who that person was. I've always thought, you know, that's a novel. Who was that person and why did they do the good? You know, there are good people in the world. That's the lesson for me.
Yeah, well, everyone's got a Holocaust story, and the ones who have survived can tell that story. Unfortunately, there were too many that didn't. But I really need to go out of this segment now. We're coming back in the next segment with some clips. You're coming into the beginning, but then we're going to show some clips of Mirka. And after that, we're coming back to you for the final segment to talk about you, Philippe Mora.
Will you be disappointed if I button up my shirt?
No. We love the sex appeal,
okay,
mate.
Thank you. Good.
Okay, we'll see you after the break with more of Philippe Mora and some clips of the one and only infamous visual artist, Mirka Mora.
Thank you.